Welcome everybody to the channel. My name is Mr. Hurricane, and today we're going to be talking about the Alliance of American Football. This is the brand new league that played its debut games last night, and after watching their first action, I wanted to come on to the channel and just talk about it and see what you all think and give you my thoughts on what this league could possibly be. After a small taste, I only got to see one game, and it wasn't the one that scored all the points, but I still had a really good time with it. So if you're not too familiar, I'll fill in some of the blanks here, but in the last couple of years, we've seen a couple leagues be created. We have the return of the XFL, and we have the Alliance of American Football. Now, I'm not going to spend this video talking about the XFL, really. They're set to debut, I think, in 2020, so the Alliance has a year head start on them, and they have a chance to maybe really get some viewership and some backing from people that just want another football product. Obviously, they're not really trying to compete with the NFL. They're starting their season a week after the Super Bowl, and they're here to kind of help fill in the gap, it looks like, as the NFL season is really short. It's far shorter than the NBA and MLB seasons. We have preseason in August, the games start in September, they end in January, the playoffs begin, and the playoffs go very quickly. After week 17, you're only 2 weeks away from only having four teams left in the entire league. So everything moves pretty quickly in the NFL, and I think a lot of us by the end of the postseason are still hoping for a little more football. And here's where the Alliance comes in. It's perfect timing, not only being a week after the Super Bowl, but a week after a very bad Super Bowl. You know, that wasn't a very fun game to watch, so I think everybody still had a bad taste in their mouths. Now, there have been some other leagues that have popped up, and I think some have popped up without even playing games. And a lot of these leagues don't do well. We've seen the Arena League close down for a while, and I think the Arena League is down to like four teams. But the Alliance is true American gridiron football. They don't have a lot of rule changes that make the game like unrecognizable, but there are some noticeable differences that I'll talk about in this video. But what really caught my attention about the Alliance is when I saw they were going to be on CBS, NFL Network, and I think a couple other channels, I'm like, okay, that's the real deal there, because people actually have that stuff. It's not going to be hidden on some channel that you have to have some special package to watch or anything, so it's going to be very easy to watch. And then I saw some of the people that were involved with it, seeing some big name coaches like Mike Martz, who coaches San Diego, Mike Riley coaches San Antonio, Steve Spurrier coaches Orlando, who put up 40 points last night. That was one of the things that really sold me, was just seeing these recognizable names: Charlie Ebersole, Bill Polian, Troy Polamalu, Hines Ward. So I'm like, okay, there's a bit of legitimacy here. You have my interest. I think they're also going to be streaming a lot of the games on their website or their app that you can download. So it's like a league you can actually easily see. And then looking at the players that are a part of it, there are so many names that I recognize. Now, it's not like big name NFL talents, but there are some players that were just in recent drafts and maybe didn't pan out and are looking for another chance. I see the Alliance as being a realistic path for players that didn't make it with an NFL team to maybe get another chance to develop their skills and have a chance then to go on to training camp come August. And I think that's going to be the case. There are a lot of players here that I recognize and I think are NFL players if they get a bit more development. The NFL 53-man rosters have around 1,700 players, and then everybody has a 10-man practice squad. So about the 2,000 best, you could say, football players are already in the NFL. I feel the players in the Alliance are practice squad, lower end of the roster quality. And in the football world, that's okay, because it's such a role-based game that as long as you're good at one thing or a couple things, there's value for you. Well, let's get into the actual on-field product, and then I'll get into some of the rule changes and everything else. But I got to watch San Antonio and San Diego, and I got in there sometime in the first quarter, and I saw that Logan Woodside was the starting quarterback for San Antonio, and I really liked him coming out of Toledo last year. I thought he would be a good day three backup quarterback option for somebody they could develop for a couple years. He did not stay in Cincinnati where he was drafted, nor the Titans, and now he's with San Antonio. And I thought he had a lot of good moments last night. One of the first things that you'll notice is that there are more on-field microphones, and you can hear a lot more of the chatter between the coaches and the players. I mean, for San Diego, at one point during the game, they had a live shot of head coach Mike Martz talk about how he was thinking about changing quarterbacks because Mike Bercovici was struggling. You'd never get that experience watching the NFL. So that was really cool. Also, you could kind of hear, there was a timeout called, I think, for San Antonio, and Logan Woodside was over there talking with head coach Mike Riley along with wide receiver Mikhail McKay, and they were like trying to plead with him to get a certain play call because they thought they could get a big play, and they ended up going with the play call, and they were very close to connecting. And that was just really cool to know what was going to happen and to hear those players interact. I feel after one night I had a better feel for like Mike Riley's personality, and I'm not super familiar with Mike Riley, but after one night I kind of see what kind of coach he is. I heard him talk all throughout the game, it seemed, and then in the post game and everything, and there was some more stuff in the locker room on the website. So it was really cool just to get an idea of these players' personalities and just to hear them talk more and not just play the game. There were also some interviews during the game of players. You don't normally see that. I know they interviewed Ron Brooks at one point, who is 30 years old and in this league. And I'm like, oh, Ron Brooks, he was just playing for Buffalo, wasn't he? Yeah, in 2015. So you see some players that you'll recognize from a few years ago, some players who were in the draft just recently. A big one is going to be Trent Richardson. Obviously, he was a big NFL bust, but I love to see a redemption tour for Trent that begins here in the Alliance, and if he can take it back to the NFL. I think it's very possible, but it's not going to be an easy path for these players, but I think that it's a reasonable one for the players that truly emerge as the best of this league. I thought overall the product was very watchable. You know, it was very NFL light. It was almost like watching a preseason game. Now, there are some things with the quality of play that are going to be noticeably worse than the NFL, and I think one of the big concerns is going to be how much offensive line play holds these teams back. They seem to be a lot more prepared for run blocking than pass blocking. I know that Mike Bercovici was sacked a ton last night, and San Diego's offense had to completely adapt to the line struggles. I know what that feels like being a Viking fan, but that has a chance, I think, to hurt some of the appeal if there isn't much offense because the O-line play isn't very good. We already saw San Diego, by the way, after one game is making a quarterback change. They're going to Philip Nelson, who played at college with Minnesota, Rutgers, and Eastern Carolina. He had a lot more mobility than Bercovici, and he made more impressive throws in the fourth quarter playing time that he got, although he was picked off, I think, just as many times. So we'll see how that goes for them, but I think that there are going to be some really fun games to watch from this league, and I wish I had a chance to watch the Orlando game. They put up 40 points, and I just think they were on the same network at the same time, and it was a regional deal, so I don't have that one DVR'd. I actually watched the game, the San Antonio-San Diego game, twice last night after it finished. I rewatched it from start to finish and just wanted to get kind of more notes and stuff so I could make this video. One of the things they're focusing on in this league is the pace of play. Now, in the NFL, you know that there are a lot of stoppages, TV timeouts. We have to do a timeout after a score, sometimes timeout after kickoff. There are just a lot of different stoppages in the game. And in the Alliance, they're making a concerted effort to not do that so much. So they don't have television timeouts. They do have some of those spots we saw this year where they kind of go small box of the game, small box of the ad with the audio, and it's usually 30, 45, 60 seconds, I think. So that was a bit more reasonable. And their goal is to get more of a real-time game length of 150 minutes compared to like 180 in the NFL. And the San Diego-San Antonio game ran about 2 hours and 40 minutes start to finish, from pre-game intro to the post-game outro. So that was really good. If you only wanted to watch the game, it was probably within that 150-minute threshold. Or at least it wasn't too far off. And I think for a sport, you know, 2.5 hours is a really solid game time. I think NBA games have a good length, and I like that, especially for a league that is on every night. If you want to stay up with a team, then it's a bit easier to do so. But I thought that the pace of play was excellent. They have a 35-second play clock instead of a 40, so that speeds things up a little bit from play to play. There was one point I checked after the final score, which was a field goal. They don't do kickoffs, so the ball just goes to the other team at their own 25-yard line. And San Antonio hit their field goal, and within 50 real-time seconds, San Diego's offense was on the field ready to run a snap. They just had a false start penalty. But that tells you the speed of play and getting from one team's possession to the next. It's a lot smoother, and I like that part of it quite a bit. Now, there are some other rule changes that are different. Some of them you might like, some of them you might not. But after a touchdown, teams must attempt two-point conversions. There are no extra point kicks. That definitely changes the strategy a bit, I think, because you're not going to have 7-point scores anymore. It's going to be 6 or 8. This is the one I think I'm having the most problem with. The defenses have a new penalty that can be called a legal defense. They cannot have more than 5 players rush the quarterback. Only 5 players or less can go across the line of scrimmage, and no defensive player can cross the line of scrimmage from more than 2 yards outside the offensive tackles. So nickel blitzing might not be possible in this league unless they're playing in tight. That's just a weird rule to me. I'm sure they have their reasoning with it. I'm not sure what it is. But you could always crowd the line and just bring 5 and make the offensive line guess who's coming and who's not. It's what the Vikings do a lot of times with their double A gap and also putting Harrison Smith on the line. They just want to create a lot of confusion, and so that's still possible. So it's not a huge deal for me, but it is a 15-yard penalty, and I got called a couple times last night. I'm assuming because it was the first game these guys have ever played where this is a thing. In addition to no extra points, there are no kickoffs. So it's a little weird seeing a football game start with Hines Ward walking out there and placing the football down at the 25-yard line, but that's the way it opens. No kickoffs, which is a pretty iconic start to a game, but it's probably cooler than it is entertaining these days with the rules changed on kickoffs, and most of them are just ending in touchbacks anyway, so I think it's a matter of time until the NFL does away with kickoffs themselves. And one thing the NFL can do is they can just look at these leagues as a test bed and be like, okay, here are things they're doing. How do fans react? What do they think? How does it impact the game? So the NFL, I think, benefits quite a bit from leagues like this that are running in their off season. They can learn a lot, and then they can get players as well. So with there being no kickoffs, the way they do onside kicks is a different concept. You will have your offense on the field instead, and you can attempt a scrimmage play from your own 28, and it must gain 12 yards. And that to me is like way more exciting than an onside kick. It's just really weird to know this game for so long and then to see a dramatic change like this. So if your team is down 2 scores late in the game, you can go score a touchdown and not have to rely on some tricky onside kick, which you probably never assume your own team is going to recover. But I mean, imagine in the NFL, if Aaron Rodgers goes out there, team down, they get a touchdown, and then you have to stop him from getting a 12-yard play. Like, I'd be terrified of that. There's a great chance of him picking that up. I think these rules make late game comebacks easier, and it makes it, I think, a lot more interesting if you're down 2 scores with less than 2 minutes to go. Because a 12-yard play, while not easy, is way easier than an onside kick. They do have rules for the onside kick. It can only be tried by a team trailing by 17 or more, so a 3-possession game, or any team can use it under 5 minutes to go in regulation. The onside conversion play is also available after any safety played from the 18-yard line. So the games last night weren't close enough to see this. Maybe today we will. I think that as soon as we see the first comeback, the first exciting comeback that comes as a result from these rules, that's when I think you're going to probably start to hear chatter about that being considered for the NFL. I think it has a great chance of being an entertaining addition to the game. I'm okay with it. Now I'm wishing that San Antonio had allowed some points toward the end so we could have seen the first onside conversion try. That would have been awesome. As far as coach challenges go, there are only two challenges per team, no challenges in the final 2 minutes of either half, as those are automatic. So similar to the NFL, but in the NFL, if you get your two challenges right, you're awarded a third challenge. And there was actually a play, I think it was a catch called on Mikhail McKay, and they ended up going to the booth, and they had audio of the guy watching it, and you knew what the call was going to be based on that. So that was also pretty cool to see. When you go to overtime in the Alliance of American Football, they have high school football rules of the Kansas playoff. I don't know, it's just what Wikipedia says. Each team will begin on their opponent's 10-yard line and be given one possession to score, with no field goals allowed. If the score remains tied after each team has been given their possession, the game ends in a tie. In the postseason, the overtime periods will be played until there is a winner, with teams alternating who goes first in each overtime period. One timeout per overtime possession. I don't like overtime starting that close to the end zone. I get you're trying to end the game. I just think you start to make the game a little bit different by shortening the field that much. Just put the ball at midfield and you get me on board, because now the whole playbook's wide open. You can go for a deep shot, you can still have that need to work yourself closer to the end zone, but there are no field goals at least. So these teams still have to find the end zone despite being 10 yards out. There are 8 teams in the Alliance. The playoffs will have the top 2 from each conference represented. And there's also a 9th member of the officiating crew, and this is one thing I see the NFL adapting as early as this season. They have a 9th member called the Sky Judge, who can review every play using technology like a booth review, and they can call or take away penalties missed or made by field officials. This might just be a thing because of the Nickell Robey Coleman hit on Tommy Lee Lewis. That might just be it, and this is probably the solution to plays like that. Pass interference has never been reviewable, and it's just a bang-bang judgment call, and we have enough technology to get things more correct. And it's so frustrating to have all these great shots as a viewer on TV, and to be like, oh, they're not using these themselves to quickly get results correct. Overall, I think leagues like the Alliance and maybe even the XFL, we'll see what happens with them, but the Alliance can try things out, the NFL can see it and perhaps adapt some of them into their own rule set. But overall, just watching the Alliance of American Football last night, I had a good time. It wasn't the best football game I've ever seen, but it was fun to watch, and I enjoyed watching the players get excited about making plays and knowing that these players, you know, if they do well enough, they're going to get training camp invites. Those rosters are 90. They have 90 spots. Some of these guys have already had a chance, but some players in football don't develop quickly, or they're fringe roster guys and they suffer injuries, or they just have, you know, maybe a bad training camp and then don't get brought back. I wonder if the Alliance is a better route for some players than going on a practice squad. I wouldn't know, but what is going to develop your skills better? Being on the NFL team, getting some guidance from those coaches and being on the practice squad, or having quality coaches in the Alliance like there seems to be and getting some actual play experience and game tape? I don't know, but I think for some players it's a viable alternative. Especially at those positions where you just need more reps and you've got to work on eliminating your weaknesses and developing. I think quarterback is going to be an interesting one to see if this experience is valuable for someone like Logan Woodside, and then he can go to the NFL and maybe stick on a roster better. And these players are getting more experience in the Alliance than they would in the NFL preseason, where there are 4 games, but they're sharing some of that with starters. The Alliance has a 10-week season. That's a lot of time, a lot of games. It looks like their primary schedule is going to be playing games on Saturdays and Sundays, most of them later in the afternoon, but not all of them. In week 2, there is a 1:00 start in Birmingham. Later in the year, they do have a Friday game, actually, in Salt Lake. So the schedule is mostly convenient, I'd say, for those that want some more football action. And obviously, it runs here during the off season. This is going to help bridge the gap between us and the NFL draft. The championship game for the Alliance is literally the third day of the draft, and I'm hoping they don't run side by side. I forget how long draft coverage goes on day three. I know it's definitely late in the afternoon, but there's a chance I'd say that they can play their game like as the draft is wrapping up. But I think this is great. I enjoyed watching the Alliance last night. I'll be watching it again today, and I plan to keep watching it. I don't really have a team I'm cheering for. If you made me select one, I'd probably go San Antonio because they have Woodside, and I like their running backs, and I liked Greg Ward last night and Mikhail McKay, their wide receivers. They seem like they're going to be a fun team. I'm not so sure San Diego is going to be very good. We'll see if Philip Nelson raises their offense, but there wasn't really many positives to take away from their offense last night. I thought play of the night, by the way, was Zach Sanchez making this interception on Philip Nelson. It was a really good play. He seemed to locate the ball and then turned around to locate the receiver and get in position and then got the interception. It was a really good looking play. So I'm looking forward to see what happens today. Hopefully we have some tight games and see one of those onside kicks come into effect. I just want to see some good football action. And knowing that these players are like NFL quality in terms of they could fight for a job, that makes me way more interested in this sport because I'm always an NFL guy, and I do hope that a lot of these players get a shot in the NFL after playing in the Alliance. I look at this league as being more of a potential farm system for the NFL, whether directly or indirectly. Maybe they remain separate and players just end up going here while new players that maybe didn't work out the previous year enter the Alliance and they can hold the draft. I would be interested in that. There's no football to watch right now besides the Alliance, and I'd say that even though it's the only option, it seems like a good one. We'll have to see how the rest of the season goes. But what did you think of the Alliance of American Football? I'm sure a lot of you got to watch the Orlando game and had some fun doing that. Leave your thoughts down below in the comment section. And if you want to hear me talk football more on the channel, even if there's not much to watch, like here I just have a screenshot. But if you want to hear more stuff like this, I think it's fun to do when I have something to say. It's draft season, so I would love to get to know these players a little bit better and then give you some of my thoughts. And I'll do a mock draft because that's requested every year, and I enjoy putting those together. But let me know what you think. Let me know if you want more stuff like this. I'll come on here and talk about the Alliance of American Football more if you want me to. But that's going to do it for today. Kalispell Week 1 is coming soon. I'm hoping to get that up tomorrow, Monday. That's the plan anyway. And I'll be working on that a bit tonight. So thank you all for watching. Please hit that like button if you enjoyed the video. Subscribe to the channel for more football action. And I will see you all again soon. Have a great day.